Hello dear students, just now I received the information that our state government extended the lockdown period up to May 7th. So once I want to share one opinion with you, if it is possible try to follow it. While watching the TV, I am observing some prominent persons who are using the mask or removing it whenever they want to speak, they want to remove it. They are removing like this. Please, this is wrong. Don't remove like that. Because if at all corona comes, and it will stay at this place only. So don't touch this place with your hands. And when you are speaking, you will spread the corona. Therefore, while speaking, if necessary, you have to cover your mouth like this. So remove the mask like this. Then it will be safe. This is what I want to share with you. Okay, now let us start our subject. Now I am going to discuss a fact. This is a fact which I want to explain to you. And what is the connection with this fact to other things is that the safety of our nation, ourselves, our neighbors, everyone. Like that only. Facts are of two kinds. One is internal and the second one is external. Internal one related to physical observation, whereas the external one related to state of mind. Now if you observe, physical observation means it can be visible, very easy to find out. By seeing the face, you can say, by seeing his acts, what he is doing, why he is doing like that, everything you can understand very easily. That is, example, certain things, certain objects arranged in a systematic way. And I heard something, somebody using some words, and I heard it and I saw that person is doing this act like this we are explaining, and they have said certain words which I heard. Like this we will give a statement very easily. But when it comes to the external, that is the state of mind, one person is having some intentions in his mind, and whether he is expressing those intentions properly or not is the question to be understood by us. So sometimes it may be possible to us, sometimes may not be. When by seeing their gestures, their acts, their behavior, when you come to a conclusion, that conclusion sometimes may be right or may be wrong. At this juncture, I want to share one case law with you. That is Ramoji Rao case. You might have studied it in your constitutional law. A particular statement came in newspapers that పెద్దల సభలో ఎగువ సభలో పెద్దల గలభ. దిస్ ఇస్ ద హెడ్లైన్స్ కేమ్ ఇన్ ద న్యూస్ పేపర్. ఇట్ మీన్స్ ఎల్డర్స్ ఫైట్ ఇన్ ది అప్పర్ హౌస్ ఇన్ ఇంగ్లీష్ ట్రాన్స్లేషన్. సో ఎల్డర్స్, ద వర్డ్ ఎల్డర్స్ మీన్స్ వాట్? జనరల్లీ దట్ వర్డ్ అట్రిబ్యూట్స్ సమ్ స్పెషల్ రెస్పెక్ట్ టు ఎ పర్సన్. వెన్ యూ కాల్ దెమ్ ఎస్ ఎల్డర్లీ పర్సన్, యూ మీన్ దట్ దే ఆర్ సమ్ రెస్పెక్టబుల్ పర్సన్స్. బట్ ఇన్ దిస్ కంటెస్ట్, when that particular word is mentioned in the paper, on that particular day there was a big fight in the council. Therefore speaker and all the members, MLCs, took it seriously and they felt that it is a defamatory statement. A very big fight took place about that particular one, because anyhow finally that case ended when our chief minister, the then chief minister, referred the matter to president, I think. And this often happens because state of mind cannot be read properly, and we mostly depend on what is visible to our eyes, and basing on that only we will give a statement. So these are the things when you are saying. Now I said here so many things. What are they? Those objects are arranged in a systematic procedure, and that particular place I heard something and I saw something, later certain words are used by the person. When I am saying all these things, now what is the relevancy between all these statements? The first doubt you must get is, when madam is going on saying so many things, what is the relevancy between these things? Irrelevant things she is going on using, and we are getting bored of these things. When you are getting bored of those irrelevant things, when you are not in a position to hear it, how a court can listen all those irrelevant things for months together, and how the court will adjudicate the matter on that particular irrelevant things. Therefore, whenever you are submitting something to the court, those facts must be relevant to each one. Elante, how it means, certain objects arranged in a systematic procedure, and these objects are observed by me. I heard some noise outside and I went there, and there I saw that a person arranging those objects in a order, and then I heard some words using by that person. Those words are that I kept a bomb in the particular things which I arranged. Within a few minutes there will be a big explosion, and by hearing it I ran away from that place. Later on my friends reminded me that it is April 1st. So like this, the facts, they all are relevant. The last one, I ran away from the place, and this is connected to the first one, the arranging of the things by a person, and then I saw it, and then now last and final one, I ran away from that place. Therefore, this is the things. Here, what is the intention of that person? Now I want to file a case because he simply made me a fool on April 1st, but I want to file a case against him on that particular thing. Can I? The law says yes, because now I will prove his intention. Behind this particular one, his intention is to see that I will think that it is a serious act and I will run away from that place, and he know that my mental condition is weak and I am not in a position to hear any explosions, other things. So when I comes to know that he is going to arrange a bomb or other things there, I will get afraid of it and I will run away from this place. When I am running because of my ill health and my BP or other problems, I may get heart attack. So his intention is to kill me. Like this, now I am connecting it. In the name of April 1st, he want to do this. Everybody think that it is April 1st act, but actual intention is that he did like this, and all these things like this I am connecting. I made them relevant, and I can prove that they are irrelevant also. It all depends on the arguments of an advocate. You might have heard a thing. I said it in class also, that a particular physician came there and he said that being a doctor, what you can do, what you cannot do, like this. They asked so many things, and they asked him finally, what is the total of 3 into 2 is equal to how much? Then he said 3 into 2 is equal to 6, because he gave some formulas and he explained the thing. Later, another person came, he is an engineer. When this question is asked, he again explained 3 into 2 is equal to 6, and the reason is, he gave his reason. Like this, all the persons gave their reasons. Finally, an advocate came there, and when it is asked to him, he said, how much you want? Put there. 3 into 2 is equal to, if you want to put 18 there, I will prove that it is correct. If you want to put there 6, I will prove that it is correct. There is no correct answer to it. Whatever I say, I will prove it before the court. I will submit, because presentation of the case, the confidence of an advocate is that presentation of the things in a proper systematic way, in a relevant way, is important here. So whenever anything happens, the relevancy must be proved before the court. When you are using the words, things, or other mental conditions, whatever it may be, when you are using these things, you must keep in mind that the relevancy of all these things is important, very, very important. Unless you prove all the relevant facts before the court, you cannot win the case. So everything is a fact. If so, what is the fact in issue? Out of all the facts that are coming to the notice of the court, certain facts are going to be decided as a fact in issue by the Honorable Court only. And if you are not satisfied with the issues framed by the Honorable Court, you can request the court to add some more issues also. And these facts in issue includes any fact from which, either by itself or in connection with other facts, the existence, non-existence, nature or extent of any right, liability or disability asserted or denied in any suit are proceeding necessarily follows. That means when a fact and issue is prepared by the court, framed by the court, that fact and issue is going to decide the right and liability of a person. Relating to this right and liability, already a suit is filed by a party where he accepted the existence of the particular right or liability, or he might have denied it, and about which now the court is going to decide whether that particular fact and issue is relevant or not. For example, A paid 10 lakh rupees to B, and at the time of receiving the amount, B promised that he is going to repay the amount within 1 year. Later, he rejected. Now, A want to file a case against B. In this case, what is the relevant fact? Whether A paid the amount to B or not. Whether A is having the financial capacity to pay the amount or not. Whether actually there is any relation in between A and B in existence or not. Because unless you are having a relation with the other party, you are not going to pay any amount. If you are a businessman, then you will pay. In normal conditions, unless there is a relation, you are not going to pay any amount to outsiders. Therefore, the relation between these two persons must be existed. And the second one, the financial capacity. And exactly at that time only, the person who is receiving the money must be in a need of money, and he might have used that money for some purpose. All these points are going to be crucial things to decide whether this particular fact issue is in existence or not. Basing on all these things only, certain conditions, we people forget those issues, and later on we recollect and we want to prove before the court. This is not possible, because at the time of filing the case itself, you are supposed to bring all the entire information before the honorable court. For everything there is an exception. Extraordinary conditions, so you can prove before the court. In ordinary conditions, it is not possible to submit the additional information to the court which you forgot to submit at the time of filing the case. Therefore, at the time of filing the case, you must be careful in writing the facts and facts in issue, and how that particular issue happened and how it affected you. And after that particular issue, when you lost something, and what attempts made by you to recover that money or other things, all these things you are supposed to present to the court at the plaint, at the first time when you are submitting the plaint to the court. In criminal cases, what is a fact and issue? For example, A murdered B. In this case, A caused B's death. This is the fact. And A intends to cause B's death. With that intention, he started to act. And next one, because of some grave and sudden provocation, this is a defense to him, from B, he made an attempt to fight with him, and it resulted into the death of B. So unintentional. Here, in grave and sudden provocation from B shows that there is no intention in the mind of A to murder B. Whereas the first two things, it shows that he did that particular act because he intends to do it, he did it. And unintentionally, because of some sudden act from B, he reacted and it resulted into the particular murder. And next one, unsoundness of mind, and due to which he don't know what he is doing and incapable of knowing the things that are going to happen, and he don't know how to use a weapon, and he don't know what are the repercussions of that particular act. Therefore, he did something and it resulted into the death of B. In all these cases, all these are relevant facts, because basing on these facts, the punishment that is going to be awarded to that person is going to change. The first one, when it is proved that he intends to cause B's death, punishment will be up to death. Whereas in other conditions, because there is a sudden and grave provocation from the other party, the punishment will be less. Whereas in unsoundness mind and incapable of knowing the things that are taking place, completely acquittal, because mind condition is not in his control. Like this, these facts, all these facts are relevant. Basing on these facts only, this particular act of murder is going to be decided by the court. Okay, now you submitted the fact and also relevant facts before the Honorable Court. Now court to give the verdict basing on the proof of that particular fact. And here, what is the fact proved and what is not proved? What is disproved? A fact is said to be proved when, after considering the matters before it, if the court believes it to exist or considers that the existence so probable that a prudent man ought, under the circumstances of the particular case, to act upon the supposition that it exists. Means any prudent man will believe, after going through these particular statements made before the Honorable Court, that that particular thing is in existence, hence it is proved. And disproved means a fact is said to be disproved when, after considering the matter before it, the court either believes that it does not exist or considers its non-existence so probable that a prudent man ought, under the circumstances of the particular case, to act upon supposition that it does not exist. So, for example, if we are the court, we all are hearing that corona is there, whether we saw it or not, but there is no need of further proof for it now. Any prudent man will believe its existence now. Like that, when the entire evidence is submitted, even though physically we may or may not be in a position to see it, but if the evidence is submitted and it is sensed, then it is proved. When we cannot sense it, it is disproved. And the facts which are not at all discussed are not proved. So these facts which are not proved may be proved in any later case if at all it is necessary. For example, here I want to conclude the lecture with one particular case. Advocates, after enrollment, starts their practice and later joins as lecturers in colleges. Whereas, in some other conditions, after completion of their LLB degree, first they join as lecturers in colleges, later they enroll themselves as advocates and starts practice. In both the cases, the qualification is LLB only. After completion of LLB, first they are becoming advocates, then they are joining as advocates, as lecturers. And first some of them joining as lecturers and later going to the profession. A case is filed before the Supreme Court by an advocate stating that all the lecturers who are working in colleges enrolled as advocates are not eligible to practice, hence their enrollment must be cancelled. In that particular case, Supreme Court held that it is true, hence all the lecturers who are practicing may either resign to their jobs or may cancel their enrollment. And the court gave some time to them. Accordingly, the case was disposed of. At the time of arguments, an issue is raised. Then, when you are discussing about the lecturers who are practicing, why can't you give the same applicability to the persons who are coming as lecturers in colleges? In that case, Supreme Court held that that issue, that fact, is not a fact and issue in this case. Hence, when an appropriate case comes before this Honorable Court, we will deliver our opinion there. Till then, it is not proved. That is what Honorable Supreme Court held in that case.